Coming up on Citrus TV News, students and the Department of Public Safety respond to the weekend incident on Ackerman Avenue. What they had to say.
And this weekend, a town hall took place to determine the fate of I-81. Find out what's next for the controversial highway.
And teachers in Denver go on strike after a year of failed negotiations. Why the negotiations broke down and what's to come.
And U.S. backed forces in Syria are making a push at a final ISIS stronghold. Citrus TV News starts right now.
This is Citrus TV News live at 6, your campus news leader.
Last night, a group of Syracuse students released a statement addressing the student body in regards to an alleged off-campus assault that took place early Saturday morning. Good evening, I'm Drew Carter.
And I'm Sabrina Maggiore. The statement you see on your screen says in part that the incident took place at the end of a birthday celebration. They say three students of color were attacked by a group of three Caucasian males and one Caucasian female, one of whom screamed a racial slur at the group. The statement says the student of color are disappointed in the way DPS and the Syracuse police handled the situation.
Now, DPS sent out two emails early Saturday about the alleged attack. DPS Chief Bobby Maldonado released a new statement earlier this afternoon in response to the events over the weekend. He detailed how the university handled the incident, but could not be specific because of that ongoing investigation. Maldonado says, quote, our Department of Public Safety is working closely with SPD to apprehend those responsible for the crime and to prevent future occurrences. We are in frequent communications with the SPD and will provide updates to our campus community when they are available, end quote. The Syracuse Police Department released a similar statement less than an hour ago with no new information. And new details about how students on campus are getting active in state politics. A group of Syracuse University students traveled to the state capitol today for a rally to support disability services on college campuses and universities. The rally was to support legislation that provides additional funding to colleges for students with disabilities. The New York State Disability Services Council says more than 60,000 students with disabilities are enrolled in New York State higher education institutions. The new funding includes $15 million to be used to further enhance students with disabilities.
And a new alumni donation will reduce program fees for iSchool immersion experiences. Alumnus Rob Harris donated $250,000 to a fund for these week-long intensive trips. On these immersion programs, students get to network with top startups and technology companies, as well as with alumni in new cities. The registration period for the next iSchool immersion experience opens February 15th.
New details on plans for I-81. Congressman Katko is hosting multiple town hall style events where Central New Yorkers can meet to give their input on how to replace the interstate in Syracuse. Over 500 people attended Saturday's forum. The central debate focusing on whether to repair or completely rethink the highway. The current viaduct runs through downtown Syracuse and has been criticized by community members for its role in splitting the city. The alternatives include replacing the viaduct with a tunnel or a community grid that would tie together areas of Syracuse currently separated by that overpass.
What I hear is a lot of dressed up, not in my backyard. So keep it where the poor people are. They moved out of the city to get away from the dirty city, but now some of the city problems might come out. But if you live in a community and you're part of a community, if you work in the city, you suffer with the city.
Officials say South Salina Street in downtown Syracuse has now reopened. The street was shut down after a water main broke last week. The water break caused disruption to water services for residents on both sides of the streets, and the water breaks tend to be common in Syracuse, largely due to aging infrastructure. Officials say the road was back open around 7 o'clock this morning.
Tonight, we learn more about a proposed solar farm in DeWitt. The town is holding a public information meeting to discuss the farm, which would be built on an old landfill and could be finished by the end of 2019. Supporters say the project will save DeWitt approximately $2 million in energy costs over the next 25 years. The meeting starts tonight at 7 at DeWitt Town Hall. And Genesee Beer is now the official beer of Watkins Glen International Racetrack. A multi-year sponsorship between the beer company and the raceway was announced earlier today. The Genesee Beer logo will appear throughout the racetrack. This marks the first sponsorship of its kind by Genesee at the racetrack in 40 years.
Lawmakers in Syracuse and Rochester have sent a letter to Jeff Bezos inviting him to consider placing Amazon's second headquarters in upstate New York. This comes amid reports that Amazon is reconsidering New York City as a potential location due to political controversy. Natural resources, low living costs, and open airspace for drones are listed as potential benefits for the company, and the headquarters would bring about 25,000 new jobs to the area. And school officials in Long Island are investigating an image of a noose posted in a middle school classroom. The image labels the noose a, quote, back-to-school necklace. The pastor who brought the image to the attention of the school district said the image is an example of a hate crime. A statement released by the school district says they have zero tolerance for racially offensive images being displayed in their schools.
Governor Cuomo and President Trump are set to meet tomorrow to discuss the president's tax plan and how those changes have affected New York State. The governor said today that the meeting is taking place at his request. Cuomo says changes in federal taxes are lowering the amount of revenue the state takes in through income taxes. The governor said he's worried that some wealthy New Yorkers will leave the state, further decreasing revenue. Now, Sabrina, I've been hearing some tough stuff about the weather that could be coming. It's been good lately.
Yeah, very nice lately, but I mean, we're hoping that weather stays away. But we have Toni Bianco here in studio to tell us our full weather forecast.
Thanks, guys. It's been pretty nice out today, actually. We saw some sun, not quite as warm as last Monday, unfortunately, but still pretty sunny and pretty nice out all around. Right now, it's about 27 degrees outside with absolutely zero chance of precipitation currently. But and tonight, as we continue that, we're going to see that those temperatures are going to continue to decline a little bit, about 20 degrees at midnight, and the winds are going to continue to pick up because on Tuesday we have a winter storm warning, and that is going to be in effect. That is going to be in effect until Wednesday morning at 7 p.m. Now, what you're going to see with that winter storm warning, which is the most severe of all winter weather alerts, is about 6 to 10 inches of snow expected, and wind gusts are going to reach as high as 30 miles per hour, but on average about 15 miles per hour. So if you're commuting tomorrow morning, I would avoid the roads if possible. Drew and Sabrina, back to you.
Coming up next, two major politicians are holding rallies about the proposed border wall just miles apart. Find out who and where they stand on the issue.
And U.S. troops are fighting again in Syria. Find out why, coming up on CitrusTV.
They said a bottle was just a bottle. That no one would ever notice me. But I knew I could be more. That one day, I would make people smile.
Adventure can be found anywhere, but the best place to start is in the forest.
I spy something beginning with S.
Snow?
No.
Snow-covered trees?
Nothing to do with snow.
Head outside to discover incredible animals and beautiful plants that come together to create an unforgettable adventure.
Wow.
So grab your loved ones.
Don't even.
And explore a world of possibilities.
Come on, this way.
Visit discovertheforest.org to find the closest forest or park to you.
When I was in foster care, I never knew when I would have to move. So I always had my suitcase ready to go. Then one day, I was adopted. My new parents opened their hearts and home to me. My parents cook my favorite breakfast for me every morning. My parents take me on trips I never thought I would go on. They gave me a home and an even better reason to use that suitcase. My parents aren't perfect, but they're perfect for me.
If you see news happening on campus, in Syracuse, or across the nation, call the Citrus TV Newsroom, 315-443-1177, or tweet at Citrus TV News, your campus news leader.
Welcome back to Citrus TV News. Moving west now as Denver public school teachers strike. They went on strike today.
The teachers say they want higher base pay as the cost of living in Denver continues to go up. After over a year's worth of negotiations failed, the two sides tried working out a deal over the weekend, but couldn't reach an agreement.
Over 90,000 students had to go to school even as those teachers strike.
So unfortunately, bonuses are really variable and we can't depend on them from year to year.
And so I'm out here to support a fair compensation system for all of our teachers. My pay has been too variable over the last several years.
I'm here because teachers and SSPs deserve a fair, livable wage where we can live in the communities that we love and care so deeply about.
The suspect in the Pittsburgh synagogue massacre has pleaded not guilty to 19 federal charges. The man is accused of killing 11 people during the attack at the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh.
He's currently facing up to 63 charges, among them hate crimes and obstruction of religious belief. Officials say the suspect faces a maximum penalty of life in prison without parole.
And 300 National Guard members originally intended to be at the border are being transferred. California Governor Gavin Newsom says he will redeploy 360 troops to other operations.
This is to focus on actual threats facing the state, according to him. This includes preparation for fire season, joining operations against drug cartels, and adding more people to the drug task force.
And in El Paso, Texas today, President Donald Trump and Beto O'Rourke will be competing at rallies later today.
O'Rourke will reportedly join a march that will go past the president's rally. The march will be against President Trump's proposed border wall.
O'Rourke told Oprah Winfrey that he would make a decision on whether he'd seek the Democratic nomination by the end of the month.
A new executive order aims to increase the use of artificial intelligence. Under the American AI Initiative, the Trump administration will direct agencies to prioritize investments in AI.
An administration official says the initiative aims to keep the U.S. advantage in AI research and development. Opponents of the initiative say AI raises ethical concerns and will result in job displacements across several industries.
And just 7 weeks since beginning in Congress, Congresswoman Ilhan Omar is under fire for earlier tweets. The tweets, viewed as anti-Semitic, face criticism from both Democratic and Republican leadership.
Omar has since apologized for the tweets. In her apology, she acknowledges that anti-Semitism is real and that she never intended to offend anyone. This comes shortly after she garnered attention over her criticism of the Israeli government.
And the latest from Syria, U.S.-backed forces are leading an assault against ISIS.
The Syrian Democratic Forces, or SDF, are fighting ISIS in eastern Syria at what is considered their final stronghold. A CNN report says at least 500 ISIS members are believed to be in the village.
This assault comes after President Trump announced last week that ISIS would be completely defeated very soon.
And Turkey is calling for the mass incarceration of Uyghurs in China to end. Uyghurs are Turkish ethnic groups made of mostly Sunni Muslims. After multiple riots between 2009 and 2012, the Chinese government have cracked down on the ethnic groups claiming they're connected to terrorists.
People who have been released from the camp, however, say they're put in forced labor camps used to rid the Uyghurs of their devotion to Islam. Turkey has kept quiet about the situation for a while, but President Erdogan is now saying it's a great shame for humanity. Turkey is also calling China out for subjecting Uyghurs to what they call torture and political brainwashing. China maintains these camps are used for job training and to fight terrorism.
And the U.S. and South Korea reached a deal on the cost of American military forces stationed in that country.
South Korea will put up around $890 million, which is up about 8% from what South Korea used to contribute. But that's far less than the reported 50% increase that the U.S. wanted.
Since the deal is only for a year, the U.S. and South Korea will likely ramp up negotiations again soon.
From the Citrus TV Weather Center, this is SU's most accurate weather forecast.
All right, we got a little tease there from Toni earlier in the show. So, Sabrina, you curious about what's going on in the weather?
I want to know. Toni, what do you got for us?
Well, guys, tomorrow morning when you wake up, unfortunately, we're going to be covered in a little bit of a white blanket of snow there, about 20 degrees early in the morning, and steady snow throughout the day. It's going to feel like 10 degrees outside with winds about 10 miles per hour or so. Now, continuing throughout the day on Tuesday, you are going to see that the temperatures are going to increase a little bit throughout the day, about 24 degrees around noon. Those snow showers early in the morning, that accumulation throughout the morning, about 5 to 8 inches. And we are going to be seeing those winds, like I said, about 15 miles per hour with gusts up to 30 miles per hour. Now, you might be wondering what the chance of precipitation is throughout the day on Tuesday and Wednesday. So what we're going to see here is that it's pretty low in the morning, and we're going to be seeing snow. At 12 p.m., though, 100% chance of snow. Now, that's going to continue throughout the afternoon and into the night. But about 8 p.m., we are going to be seeing a shift to a wintry mix of both rain and snow, and that's going to continue throughout the night. And Wednesday morning, when you wake up, we're going to be seeing some snow again. So our 5-day forecast, you might be wondering, is that snow going to continue? No. Tuesday and Wednesday, you are going to be seeing that winter storm. But Thursday, if you're looking to take that special someone out, the weather is going to be pretty clear. So fortunately for you guys, Valentine's Day is safe. Drew and Sabrina, back to you.
Thanks, Toni. Can't wait to go out by myself. Coming up next, big wins and broken records. Find out who made history at the Grammys last night.
And if you think McDonald's has enough food on their menu, well, just wait. There's a new addition, and it's only here for a short time. Stay tuned to find out what it is.
Patriotism. It inspires passionate debate, and it's worn like a badge of honor with good reason, because it means love and devotion for one's country. But what really makes up this country of ours? It's the people. To love America is to love all Americans. This year, patriotism shouldn't just be about pride of country. It should be about love, love beyond age, sexuality, disability, race, religion, and other labels. Because love has no labels.
The Grammys saw some Syracuse representation as rapper Post Malone performed, but the Syracuse native did not win an award last night. His album Beer Bongs and Bentleys and his song Rockstar were each nominated for Grammys, but the prizes ultimately went to non-Syracuse natives. This year's Grammy winners didn't just take home awards, many made history too. Childish Gambino's This Is America became the first rap song to win both Song and Record of the Year. Cardi B became the first female solo artist to win Best Rap Album. Dua Lipa also walked away with the title of Best New Artist. Other highlights of the night were a surprise appearance by former First Lady Michelle Obama and a tribute performance to the late Aretha Franklin.
And this year's Super Bowl may have been the lowest scoring in history, but CBS says the ratings aren't as low as they first thought. CBS added 12 million more viewers to its tally after calculating the out-of-home measurement. The measurement includes people who watched at places like bars, friends' houses, or even restaurants. The initial number of just over 100 million Super Bowl viewers was the lowest in a decade. And Facebook is now in the furniture business. The company has acquired the shopping startup Grokstyle. The startup uses artificial intelligence to help users buy furniture, and Facebook says the new team will contribute to their AI capabilities.
Toys R Us may have officially closed last year, but it might make a comeback in the near future. The company's former creditors are now running True Kids Brands as the new Toys R Us. The new owners say they are looking at new plans for the U.S. market. Brick-and-mortar stores and online sales are being considered for the near future.
And McDonald's is getting a new addition. The fast food chain will be adding donut sticks to the menu. This won't be a late night fix though, it's for breakfast hours only. The cinnamon sugar flavored pastry went through two test periods in 2018, and the limited edition item will be available starting February 20th.
Now happy National Oatmeal Day, everyone. After the break, we'll be stirring up the sweets of sports into a nice mush that you can dissolve and then quickly digest and talk to your friends about. So stay with us. We'll be right back.
They told me a bottle couldn't dream. That I would never become a superhero. But I learned how to fly. Just to come back in a new disguise. And be the hero that I've always wanted to be.
And now, your Citrus TV Sports Report.
Welcome back. I'm Zach Allen with sports. Now, everything is bigger in Syracuse. Saturday, the Dome had the largest on-campus crowd in all of Division I on the year when Boston College came to play. The Orange looking to topple the Eagles just like they did 10 days earlier, and they did just that. Now, Cuse looking to match their ACC wins from last year at 8. Cuse undefeated when Tyus Battle scores more than 11 points. He gets started early with a nice lay-in to get the Cuse going. Now, Buddy Boeheim was the real story, though, as he hits this one from 3. He shot 80% from behind the arc with a career-high 16 points on the night. O'Shea Brissett finds the coach's son. That was his third double-double on the year, third straight. But Kai Bowman was a big force for the Eagles. He had 21 points, the same number he had, coincidentally, as they faced 10 days earlier. But that wasn't enough as Tyus Battle gets the steal, goes down all the way for the fast break dunk. Cuse takes the game 67-56. But Frank Howard only played 21 minutes. Coach Jim, where's the senior point guard at?
Well, Ty can't play the whole game at point. It's not a good position for him in the long run against the teams that we have to beat. We got to have another guard, and you're not going away from a senior guard. Frank Howard's going to play, okay?
And the Orange women followed that, showing up with their own beatdown of the Eagles. SU hosting BC yet again yesterday in the Dome, this time for the Play for K game. So the women rocking some sweet pink jerseys. Now, Tiana Mangakahia has been the story for the Orange thus far, but the Aussie was silenced by BC with just 5 points on the night. Didn't matter, though, as her supporting cast showed why they deserve to be ranked 15th in the nation. Freshman forward Emily Angstler produced her fourth double-digit performance on the year, and the real breakthrough came in the form of Miranda Drummond. The redshirt senior posted 24 points on the evening, drilling 6 of her 9 shots from the three-point line and propelling the Orange to a 96-69 W. You just can't script it better than that, right, Coach Q?
She just really came out being aggressive, and I thought that she really looked for a shot early, and she didn't really pass up many looks. I mean, she really just got into a groove, and she's a rhythm shooter, and she got into a good rhythm today. I thought she just made shots from being in a good rhythm. She looked like she was in the flow. She was catching the ball and getting right into her shot, so I just thought she had really good rhythm today and good pace.
And now the NCAA plays its best version of The Bachelor, naming 30 women as their candidates for this year's Naismith Trophy. On the list for the Player of the Year award is Tiana Mangakahia. The SU junior leads the team in scoring, assists, and rebounds per game, and just recently recorded the first triple-double in school history. On March 4th, we will find out if the Australian will get a rose and advance to the semifinals for this prolific award. Now, Friday was not National Oatmeal Day, because today is, obviously, but the SU men's lacrosse team came out playing like mush. Their loss to Colgate has sent them spiraling in the rankings. They've dropped to 20th in the Inside the Cross rankings and completely out of the coaches' poll. Last time they thought of the rankings was in 2012 when Chris Daddio was just a sophomore for the Orange team. How can you forget Daddio? And from Coastal Carolina to Coastal Syracuse, defensive end Jeffrey Gunter is taking his talents to Central New York to join the Orange next year. The junior recruit will help fill in for Alton Robinson and Kendall Coleman, who are playing in their final season next year. And tonight, get situated on the couch. Set your DVRs. The Knicks take on the Cavaliers at 7 o'clock. What to watch for? Who loses? These two teams are in last in the East, and it appears to be an all-out tank race in the pursuit of Zion Williamson. Catch this game on MSG or don't. Meanwhile, the Nets head to the land of fake bacon and Justin Bieber. The Toronto Raptors hosting Brooklyn tonight in a rematch of their thrilling overtime game in December, where the Nets stole a dub and have gone 21-10 since that game. The sixth-place Nets have not won in Canada, though, in 4 years. You can find this showdown on YES at 7:30. Drew.
All right, lots of good stuff there, Zach. Lots
so much going on.
But one thing you didn't mention is the American Alliance of Football. Now, my question for you, is this a fad, Chad, or Brad?
You know, I gotta say, this is a big Chad. This is a great idea. People want football all year long, and that's a big Chad move. I mean, we see some great hits, some great highlights. I don't think that this is not a bad idea.
We all love a good Chad, right?
Absolutely.
Definitely know what that means.
Coming up next, find out what free friends invaded a Russian town on the other side of the break. Stay tuned.
I see you mobbing over her. Let's go. Let's mob. Let's crawl. Let's crawl. Let's crawl. Hey, yo, we mobbing. Come on, girl. Let's crawl. Hey, yo, let's crawl. Hey, yo, let's crawl. Hey, let's crawl. Hey, yo, let's crawl.
All right, welcome back. Toni Bianco is here.
Toni, what's the situation? What are we supposed to dress tomorrow?
Right, so it's not quite going to be cold enough to bring out your ski gear, but you are going to want to layer up because you're going to be facing that snow all day long tomorrow. It's going to be rough.
So I have to break out a bigger jacket is what you're telling me.
If you have a bigger jacket, I don't have a bigger jacket than the one I'm currently wearing.
Sad.
All right, thanks, Toni. Now, imagine waking up and being scared to go to class because your town is being invaded by bears. That far-flung scenario has become reality for residents of one remote Russian town. Since December, more than 50 polar bears have descended on the town of Novaya Zemla. It's a lot of bears for the settlement of just 2,500.
There have been reports of bears chasing people and entering buildings. Parents' fears for their children has led to schools installing extra fences near kindergarten classes. Attempts to scare the bears off with dogs, vehicles, and signals have all been unsuccessful in deterring what officials have called a mass invasion. This is actually terrifying.
I want to know who's trying to scare these things off with their dog.
Yeah, like, who's doing that?
What world is that going to?
There is no way to scare a polar bear. I'm pretty sure.
So?
I don't think so.
What about with a Pepsi?
I'm team polar bear. They're so cute. The little polar bears, they're
they
cute.
They are cute. Tell that they're to a polar bear.
I will go right up to one and talk to it.
I think they're cute. I do think they're cute. They are cute. Well, that's all the time we have for you tonight on Citrus TV News. Make sure to follow us on Twitter and like us on Facebook. I'm Drew Carter.
And I'm Sabrina Maggiore. Have a great night, Syracuse.